Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to be showing you how to make this time distortion effect. So here you can see that there is all these particles flying around and there is also this prismatic look. And if I get near to a mesh, you can see that the particles spawned will be more, and if I move far away from it, less and less particle will spawn on it like this. So you can also see this ground wave moving through the mesh like this. And here you can see that the particles that are coming out of the mesh will have the color of the mesh also. And here if I get close to this particle system, you can see that it slows down. And if I get close to it, you can see that it is also slowing down. And if I move close to this, you can see more particles are spawning on it. And here we have an effect like this on this pipe. So this is what we are going to be creating today. And if you want to download the entire finished project file, you can support me on my Patreon. And for $5, you can download this project file and also project files from almost all my previous tutorials. And if you are already my patron, thank you very much for supporting this channel. So with this, you can select a static mesh and you can go to the Niagara system and kind of reduce the particle individually also if you want. Like I can set this to 20 and I can set the refraction size to like 20 also, so it will be smaller. So we can select all of this and have their individual sizes, etc. And we can also change the color of the wave, etc. And also the amount and the number of lines, I can set this to like 5 or something like that. And there will be more lines. And also I can change the speed to like whatever I want. So in the end, there will be a lot of settings you can change. You can also change the radius if you want. I can change that to like 5000 or something like that. So it will be really huge. So this is what we are going to be creating today. And you can also increase the height. So I can set this to like 200. And I will set the radius to 900. So it looks like this. I can reduce the speed. I can increase the height more. So you will get effect like this. So this is what we are going to be creating today. So first we will create the material for the Niagara system. So right click, then material, and I will call this m_flakes, then open it up. Then we can set this to a masked material and also change the shading model to unlit. Then we can get a particle color node and connect this to the MEC color. So this will allow us to bring in the color from the Niagara system into the material. And now for opacity mask, we can get this texture. I will provide a link in the description below so you can download the textures you need. So bring that in and connect the red channel to the opacity mask, since we only need the linear values. And this will mask it like this. Now click apply. Now we can bring in a cube from here like this. And now right click, then go to effects, then Niagara system, then click next, then click on fountain, then click add, then finish. And we can call it NS flakes, then open it up. So here we want to disable the gravity because we don't really want the particles to fall down. And we can also reduce the speed to like 40. And 70. And now we can add a curl noise. So add, then curl, noise force, then click on fix issue. It will just add solve force velocity here. And for the noise strength, we can give like 150. So we will get some random motion. And for the sprite render, we can give this flake material. here into the material slot. So we get something like this. And now we can go to emitter properties and change this to a GPU simulation. And we can also click fixed bounds because this is a GPU simulation and we don't really want it to de-render when our camera moves away from it. Now here we can see the spawn rate, and if you want to control it from here like this, if you want to control the spawn rate here and get a parameter to control here, we can go to user exposed, then click plus, and here we can type in float, and we can name this flake amount, and we can drag that in. And we can set a default value by going into the user parameter. And here we can set a default value of like 200 or something like that for now. And now if we go here, we can select this. And here we can change the amount. We can change this to like 10 if you want. Now we want this to sample the shape of this static mesh. So in order to do that, we can go to particle spawn and type in, and here we can type in sample static mesh, and we can add a default queue for now, and we can also plus this and type in static mesh location. So after we sample the static mesh, we will use this static mesh location to set the particle position and also the particle normal. So now it looks like this, and if we just drag this into the cube, we can see it is spawning from the cube. But now if I just bring in another probe like this one, and now if I just drag this in, it doesn't really spawn on it because we need to select the static mesh, and we can go here and we can type in CPU access. We need CPU access for this particle to spawn. So now if I increase the count like this, you can see more particles spawning from the static mesh. But if I go here and untick allow CPU access, then you can see that nothing is spawning. So we need to allow CPU access for static mesh to spawn. So now if I just increase the count, you can see that it is spawning. But if I untick this and go here and increase the count, you won't see anything spawning, but it is spawning, but it's inside the static mesh and not on it. So we need this CPU access. In this mesh, I have already done that. So if I go here and type in CPU access, I have already done that. So now I will just delete this. Now, if I just drag in this grass material onto this cube, you can see that the color doesn't change. So this is what we are going to do next. So we can go to the NS particle and go to particle spawn. Then we can create a new scratch pad. And we can type in gbuffer color for the name. And here we can go to this plus. And here we can type in gbuffer. This is an experimental feature and it will only work on the GPU particle. So from here we can drag and type in decode base color, and for screen UV we can type in position and get the particle position. So this particle position will be in world space, but we want a screen UV. So for that, we can drag and type in to screen space, or type in world position to screen UV. And now we get the screen UV. We can connect this to the screen UV here. And here we can press the plus icon again and type in color, then select the particle color, and now connect the base color to the particle color and click apply. Now here you can see that our particle is taking the color of the cube, And now if you want to make the particle come a bit in front of the cube, we can type in camera offset and we can bring it up like this and type in 30 or something like that. So now we have our particle working. Now we need to turn this off when our camera is far away or our player is far away from the object. So in order to do that, we can go to the emitter update, and here we can press the plus icon and type in scratch pad and type in new scratch pad, and here we can type in camera, then select the new camera, and here we can drag and type in get camera properties CPU and GPU, and with this we can get the camera world location. And now we can add and type in position, and this time we are going to get the position of the engine. We don't really want the position of the individual particles because we haven't even spawned them yet. So we can get the engine position, and here we can drag and type in distance based fall off, and for the end position we can get the camera location. And for the distance, we can just drag and connect this here. So we can change this in the scratch pad after we compile that. So now we will add a float here. So press this and type in float. And we will rename this to spawn probe. And change the namespace to emitter. So we get this in the emitter attributes here. So now connect the normalized distance inverter to the spawn probe and click apply. So now we get the spawn probability here. We can use this to control the spawn rate here, but before that we will just rename the scratch module to distance check. So here we are just comparing the distance between the camera and the Niagara system, and with that we will get a normalized distance. So with this we will get a value between 0 and 1. We will use this value to drive the spawn probability. So if it is 1, all the particles will spawn, and if it is 0, none of them will spawn. So now we have to bring it up before the spawn rate, and for the spawn rate we can go here and click this spawn probability here, this one, and we can just drag in the new spawn probability we created. So we can just drag that in. So here this distance check will compare the distance between the Niagara system and the camera, and with that distance we will get a normalized value between 0 and 1. So that value will control the spawn probability, this one here also. That controls this spawn probability value here. So now for the distance we can give something like 1000, and now if I bring the camera back you can see that nothing is spawning, and if I bring it closer you can see that a lot of particles are spawning. Same when we play as the third person character, when we get close a lot of particles spawn, and when we get far nothing will spawn like this. We can also set this distance to like 100 or something like that. If so, then nothing will spawn even if we get close. Like it will only spawn if we are very close like this. And we can also set this to like 10,000 or something like that. So now even if we are far away, it will spawn like this. We will just set this back to like 1000. Now we can go to initialize particle, and then we can set the size to like 12 and 16. So it will be bigger. Now we can set the spawn rate here to 90 or something like that. And now we can spawn a bunch of smaller particles. So we can just duplicate this and set the spawn rate here to some default values like 2000 or something like that. And we will just set the size to like 2 and 6. Now we can just delete this one. We don't really need that. So if you want to individually control this rate also, you can create another float here if you want, like this. But I'm just going to leave it like this. So now we will create the prismatic effect. So right click, then material. I will call this m_prism. Then open it up. Then set the blending mode to translucent and the shading model to unlit. So now we need two textures for it. I will provide a link in the description below so you can download this also. So bring these two in. And now get a UV coordinate by pressing and holding U and clicking. Then get a rotator. So this will just rotate the textures a bit. Like this. You can set the sample source to clamp if you don't really want it to repeat. Now for refraction, we can get a particle color node and get a lerp and connect this to the alpha and connect this to the refraction. So one is the refractive index of air. So if the value is 1, we won't really see any distortion, but if the value is anything above or below 1, we will see some distortion. So for A, we can get a constant by pressing and holding 1 and clicking, and now connecting this to A, and we can set this value to like 0.2. This will control the distortion. And for a refractive material to work correctly, we need to provide a neural map. But first we will just multiply this neural map with this texture so we can add some patterns in it. And now connect this to the normal. And for opacity, we want this to be fully transparent, so we can get a constant again with a value of 0, so it will be fully transparent, and connect that. Now click apply. So now we won't see anything because this value is 1, but if I just connect this to the refraction, you will see some refractions like this. So this is what we want. The particle system will control the alpha value, so it will change over time. So now connect this here and click apply. If you want, you can also 1 minus this, so we can also get a preview. So you can get a preview, and when this value becomes 0, it will be 1. So that will be the refractive index of air, and we won't really see any distortions. Now we can go to the Niagara system. And now we can just duplicate this. And we can call this refraction. And here for the sprite render, we can add the new material we created, this one. And now for the spawn rate, we can change this to like 20 or something like that. And here for the size, we can give a size of 40 and 120. So here if I get close to this, you can see some refractions happening. So I will just disable both of these. So here you can see distortion a bit better. I will change the simulation to CPU simulation. And I will just delete the gbuffer color because it doesn't really work on the GPU particle. So just delete that. Now you can see some distortions. I will go here and I will just set the velocity to like 10 and 30. And here we can set the initial size to 100 and 200 maybe. And we can set the spawn rate to like 8. So now if I press play, if I get close to the cube, you can see the distortion also happening. Maybe we can increase the spawn rate to like 15. So you can experiment with these values if you want to get a look you want. So I'll just enable this fountain also. So now we get all the effects. So here for the curl noise, we can give a value of 20 to the noise frequency. So we get something like this. Now we can just select this stair and we can just add this like this. So we get that effect on the stair also. Remember, you need to enable CPU access on the stair also if you want to get the effect. Now we will create the material for the floor. So for that, right click, then material, m_floor, then open it up. So here for the base color, you can get any texture you want. So I'm just going to get this concrete tiles, normal and base color, and just connect both of them in like this. Now we can get a UV coordinate by pressing and holding U and clicking, and we can get a multiply. And now if we increase the value, this texture will repeat itself, so it won't be really large on the mesh. So now we can apply this material instance to the floor like this. So we get this nice floor. So now we will create the waves. So for that, open the material, then type in sphere mask. So this sphere mask will draw a sphere on the mesh using the two locations we provide and also the radius and the hardness. So here for now we will get a whirl position for A, and for B we will get actor position. We will change this later. And for radius we will press and hold S and click to get this scalar parameter, and we can call this radius and change the value to like 1000 and connect this to the radius. Now get a constant and connect this to the hardness and give it a value of 0.1. Now if I connect this to the MSC color and click apply, you can see that we have a nice smooth sphere on the ground like this. Now we want to make this wave. So one way to do that is by using a sine function. So a sine function oscillates between -1 and 1 depending on the value we input. No matter what the value is, it will only oscillate between -1 and 1. So we can use this to create a wave. So in order to control the amount of lines we create, we can multiply this sphere mask with a scalar parameter called lines, and we can give a value of 2. Now in order to animate the wave, we can add time with it. So we get an add node, then we can type in time. And we can get a multiply node, and we can get a scalar parameter, and we can call this speed, and we can connect this to the multiply. So we can control the speed by multiplying the time. And if we add that with the sphere mask, since this sine value only moves between -1 and 1, and this time always updates, we will get an oscillation. So if I connect this here and connect this to the MC color, I now change the speed to like 1 and click apply. We get this wave like this. Now here, we are also getting the negative value. We don't really want that. So in order to cancel out the negative 1, we can add 1 to it. So negative 1 will become 0 and 1 will become 2. So if you multiply that by 0.5, we will get this value between 0 and 1. Now we can get a power node and a lerp and connect this to the alpha and connect this to the MC color. Now we can get a vector parameter by pressing holding V and clicking, and we can call this color and change the color to like a cyan color like this and connect this to 1. So whenever this sine value is 1, we will show the cyan color. So we get this waving cyan color here, and by controlling this power, we can control the width. So we can get a scalar parameter and we can type in MC width here, and if I increase this value, and now if I click apply, you can get something like this. So here we get this issue at the end, and also here in the middle you can see this big sphere. We don't really want this big sphere in the middle and also at the end, so we are going to mask them out. So now in order to mask out the middle, we can get this sphere mask. We can power this by 5 or something like that. We can 1 minus that and we can get a multiply, and we can connect this to the base and click apply. So now there is nothing in the middle, but there is still something at the end. So in order to prevent that, we can get another multiply. So one thing to note here is that in this sphere mask, the center will be white, and when it go out from the center, the value kind of decreases. So if we just multiply the sphere mask without the sign or anything like that, the value will decrease as it goes from the center to the outer radius. Now connect this to the power and click apply. So now we get nothing because this one and this inverter one is canceling each other out. So in order to prevent that, we can get a multiply and we can connect this here and connect this here. And we can get a saturate node because we don't really want the values to go above 1. And now for the multiply, we can give a value of 10 or something like that. Now click apply. Now we get nice smooth gradient like this. So here you can see that the mesh isn't going up and down. So in order to do that, we can enable tessellation on the mesh. But one thing to note here is that we don't really want every mesh in the world to have tessellation at the same time. So at the end of the tutorial, I will show you a way to use the LOD system to control which materials has the tessellation and which doesn't. So now we get the tessellation. Now here we can just duplicate both of these. And here we can rename this to tessellation width and set this to 2 and connect this to the base and get a multiply and get a constant 3 by pressing and holding 3 and clicking, and just set the B value to like 1 because we want our mesh to go up and down. And here you can see in the axis, the C value is color coded to be blue. So if we give 1 to blue, the mesh will only go up and down and not sideways. So we want that. And now we can get a multiply and we can get a scalar parameter and we can call this height. This will control the maximum height of the waves So we can give a value of 120 here for now. And now we can connect this to the world displacement and click apply. So now we have this nice wave. We can also reduce the tessellation width to like 1. So now I think it's a bit more smoother. So this is what we want. Now we can also drag this into the stairs and here. I will just delete this because this is kind of a weird mesh. And now we have an effect like this. Now we need to make this wave follow our player character. So we can get a parameter collection. So go to materials and textures, material parameter collection, PC data. So name it PC data. And then add a vector parameter. And we can call this location. Then we can open up our third person character. Then first we can go to the construction script and we can drag in the capsule component. And here we can type in set vector parameter value and change the collection to PC data and change the parameter name to location. And from the capsule, get the world location and connect that to the parameter value. Then click compile, then go to the material. Then here for the actor position, we will replace that with the parameter collection. So for that, right click, then type in collection. Then change the parameter name to location. Then component mask this. So we only need the RGB value. We don't really need the alpha. And this will only accept the 3 vector. So if I connect this, it will give an error. So connect this. Now click apply. Now if you look at it, it is spawning from the character, but when we move, it doesn't really update. So in order to fix that, we can go to the third person character again. And now here we can type in tick, then get event tick, then just copy all of this. And now get a branch. And connect this here, and connect this here, and now connect this to the true. So every tick, we will supply the location of the capsule component to the material. So if you want to optimize this, you can add a condition, and we can only use this when this condition is true. So if you want the time distortion, you can set that boolean to true, and you can optimize it that way. Now if I press play, you can see that when I move, the effect also moves with the character. So now if you want to add this effect to a new material, you can just open the material. And here we can set this to tessellation also. And set this to PN triangles and crack free displacement. And here, since this is a cube, we don't really need the waves, so we can just go here. And now we can copy all of this and all of this part. We don't really want the MC part. And we can just copy that. And we can paste it here. And then connect this part to the world displacement and click apply. Now you can see the cube also displacing. So if I get closer, you can see the effect. You can also add it to this gray material also if you want. So now to add the texture to the base, bring in this texture. And now we can just multiply this color with the red channel of this texture. And connect this to the B and click apply. So here you can see that the texture size doesn't really matter between the different meshes. That's because we are using different coordinates for the different meshes, and the different meshes have different size. In order to fix this, we can project it using the world position. So here, just duplicate this absolute world position and just paste it here and get a divide. Then we can compound and mask this. So we really need the R and G value, because the UV here only takes a 2 vector. So we only need the R and G. Then connect this here and then set the divide to like 1000 or something like that. Then click apply. Now we are just projecting it using the world position node. So now the size remains same. Maybe we can just try like 100 or something like that. Let's see what that do. So it's smaller now. Maybe we can set that to like 600. So we get something like this. Now here we can see some distortion, but we don't really want the texture to appear in this part. So in order to prevent that, we can just go here, and here we can get a multiply and connect this to here. Now we can get a vertex normal. So now if I just connect this vertex normal to the MSC color and click apply, we can see different colors. So the faces that are flat, we can see it's blue, and we only want the MSC color to appear on the flat portions. So in order to get that, we can connect this to the MSC color, and here we can just bring this in, and here we can just break this into 3 components. Then we can get the B value, we can get an absolute, because it also has a negative, so it will make that positive also. So anything that points downward will be negative, but we will also make that positive. Now if I click apply, now you can see that the MSC color texture only appear on the flat portions of the mesh like this. Now if I get close to the stairs, you can see the effect, and if I go far away, you won't see the effect. You can also select this mesh and you can add that component in. And we can add this component in also. And here also you can add this component in. So if you get some popping in effect, you can just select that mesh and type in bound and set this to like 2 or something like that. So if you have some mesh that is popping in and out, you can just set the bound scale to 2 or more, so it will be fixed. It's a GPU issue, but if you play with the bound value, you can fix that also. So now I will just select this mesh and select Niagara particle, and here I will change the flake amount to like 1000, and here I can select the Niagara particle. I can change the flake amount to like 5000. And now if I press play, I can see a lot of flakes coming out. So if the GPU particles kind of disappears, one thing we can do is that we can go to the Niagara particle system. Then we can go to the emitter properties. And here for the bounds, we can change all of this to 1000. So it will stop de-rendering. We can also do that here also. Now if I press play, the particle won't de-render no matter where I look. You can also increase the count of the prismatic material to like 30 or something like that. So there is more of it. You can add the material and the Niagara system to all of this. We can also increase the size of the refraction, so 200 and 300 if you want. So it will be more prominent like this. If you do that, you can also decrease the spawn count to like 18 or something like that. We can also do an individual control. So if you go to the Niagara system, and here if you add a float, and here we can type in refraction size, and we can set this to like 50, and for the maximum we can drag this in, and here we can set the default value of the maximum to like 300 or something like that. But here we can select this Niagara system, and here for the default size we can give a value of 100, so it will be smaller like this. But here we can select this and change this to like something very big. So now we can individually control the effects. You can do this. You can do stuff like this for all this parameter here, like the spawn rate, everything you want. Now to create the particle slowing down effect, for that we need to create a blueprint. So I will create an actor and I will name this BP time. Then open it up. Then here I will add a particle system. And here we can add this fire, so we can see it animating like this. And here now we can add a sphere collision, so we can see if the player is near the system. And now we can increase the size like this. So maybe that's a little too big. So something like this. And now we can bring that into the world. And bring it here. And now we can go to the event graph, and we can now select the sphere collision, and we can go to begin overlap, and here we can do a cast to third person character. So whenever third person character enters the sphere collision, we will get an event here. So connect this to the object, and here whenever third person character enters the sphere, we will do something called a custom time dilation. So with custom time dilation, we can set time dilation for one particular actor. So I will change this value to like 0.1 and select the sphere collision again, and on component end overlap. So whenever third person character leave the sphere collision, we will set the custom time dilation back to 1, so it will be normal again. So I will set this to 1, and now if I press play, so now you can see that it is animating. And now if I get close to it, nothing happens. So let's see what's happening here. So here we are supposed to cast this to third person character, not the anim blueprint, so just delete that. Now click play. Now if I go near it, you can see that it is very slow. And if I go back, you can see it playing at the normal speed. So if you set this to like 0, and if I go in, you can see that it is paused completely in time. So we can set this value to like 0.5. So it will be slow like this. And if I go away, it will play at the normal speed. So here one thing to note is that this material is really expensive because we are also using the tessellation and also all this stuff. So we don't really want it to be applied to the static meshes in the world all the time. So one way to fix that is by using the LOD system. So now if I just select this chair, and if I open this up, and here we can add a material slot, and we can add the same material to it like this. And for the first material, this one, we can add this concrete material we created. So this one and this one. So we have this two material. So with the LOD, we can tick custom. And now we can create two LODs. So here you can go to number of LOD and change this to 2 and click apply. So here we have this material. And here we have this LOD one. So this LOD 0 is the maximum LOD. So this LOD one will be taking place when we get far away from it. So now we will just set that up. So here for LOD 0, this material is the floor material, the one we created. And for LOD 1, it should be the chair material, this one. And here we can see the screen size. So if I just go here and untick auto compute LOD distance, we can set the screen size. So if I set this to 0.8, so here when I get closer, you can get this material. So you can control that by controlling the size of the material on the screen. So here if I change this to like 0.5, this material only gets applied when it is 50% smaller on the screen. So if I get far away, this material happens. So one way you can add this, complex material to the couch is that you can just go here to the chair material, duplicate that, open that up, then copy paste all of these things inside this, and then set that to LOD 0 here. And this LOD 1 will be the normal texture without any of this complicated stuff or tessellation. So one more thing we need to take care of is that when we go far away, even if nothing is spawning from this Niagara system, it is still updating because this emitter update has to check the distance to the camera every time, every frame. And if the distance is lower than 1000, it will spawn a particle. But even if it isn't spawning any particle, this update always happens, this emitter updates. So one way to fix that is by going into the static mesh, then we can select the Niagara system, and here you can type in auto activate, and you can untick this. And now if I press play, the emitter system isn't activated. So we can activate in many ways. So one way to do that is by doing a multi sphere trace by channel or profile or object, and then from here you can get all the object it hit. And you can just break this. And here you can type in hit component and type in cast to Niagara component. And from here you can type in activate and tick reset. And if you want to deactivate this, you can drag this and type in deactivate. So after this effect you want is done, you can deactivate the Niagara component on the static meshes. All you have to do is get a reference to the static mesh component, then just disable auto activate here, and in the blueprint you can cast to the Niagara component and activate or deactivate it. By doing that, this emitter isn't getting updated every tick, but only when it is activated. So I think that's it for the tutorial, guys. Thank you very much for watching. And if you want to download the project files, you can check out my Patreon. The links will be in the description below. Thank you very much for watching.